morning to all of you, and I'd like to thank also Euromed Middle East to this great opportunity to share with you our knowledge and experience about the interaction between the adiabatic humidifier and the heat exchanger. Because nowadays, due to the COVID-19 situation, the suggestion is to avoid as much as possible the recirculation, to avoid the cross-contamination between the supply and exhaust flows. In this context, the indirect evaporative cooling technology that belongs to the connection between the adiabatic humidifier and heat exchanger is the most promising technology. So we are going through this type of solution, talking a little bit at the beginning about the theory that is at the basis. Then we go through the components, the performance, and we are going to focus at the end on two main case studies that are representative of this type of solution. In fact, the indirect evaporative cooling technology, let's say, so the heat exchanger plus the adiabatic humidifier, is the most promising technology in this context because, due to the avoiding of the recirculation, we need to reduce as much as possible the running costs that are increasing due to the full fresh air and air. This technology works with the adiabatic humidifier that is spreading and wetting the humidifying the exhaust air, let's say one airflow, to cool down the other side, the other airflow. In the way we are working mainly on the wet bulb temperature of one of the two airflows. In the way we can decrease the whole temperature, the average temperature of the whole system. We are not talking now about the exchange between the dry bulb temperature, but between the wet bulb temperature of one airflow with the dry bulb temperature of the other airflow. In this way, it's easy to understand that you can reduce the energy consumption of your unit, especially during the summer period, the hot period. So, where can we use this type of technology? Where can we install or also retrofit? Because it's really compact solution, because you have just a heat exchanger that maybe you have already in your handling unit, and the adiabatic humidifier that can spray water inside the heat exchanger. You can use almost everywhere. I mean, you can use in standard ventilation systems like school, hospitals. We will see later a case study, malls, theaters, museum, hotel, swimming pools, arenas, farm, pharmaceutical industries, and also in industrial application like data center. Data center, this is like installation example that is pushing a lot, because especially in the type of application, we can have a big saving. The heart of the system is composed by, we said before, also by the type of the presentation, is composed by the adiabatic humidifier that is able to spray this water, so it's able to humidify the water, and of course the heat exchanger. That is the element that permit the exchange of the heat between the two airflows. Let's go through these two components, the adiabatic humidifier. The adiabatic humidifier, compared to the standard solution like a wet pad, for example, has a much better absorption efficiency because of the size of the droplets. With a small amount of space, you can have really high absorption, so you can easily humidify with a better efficiency the air. And then you can control really well, better way, the temperature, so you can control the quantity of the water that you want to spray, controlling then easily the set point of the air. And of course, compared always to the wet pad, we have a reduction in maintenance because you don't have to substitute the wet pad, but it's just a rack with a cabinet that is able to pressurize the water. And of course, the main characteristic of the adiabatic humidifier in medium pressure compared to the wet pad is that with this you are able to wet the heat exchanger. Because the indirect evaporative cooling technology, as I said before at the beginning, is something that is used to cool down the air, so to cool the air before the heat exchanger, but also inside the exchanger, because we have seen during our experience, our test in our lab and university, it's really important to wet also the surface of the heat exchanger. And let's now go through the plate heat exchanger that, of course, at the beginning has already the best dry efficiency that translates later in a best evaporative cooling performance and can be used the evaporative cooling solution when it is needed, so when the temperature outside is going to be really it's going to be high, too warm to use just the dry performance of the heat exchanger. Of course, another point is that it guarantees the best tightness between the two airflows. That means that the indirect evaporative cooling technology can still keep the humidity of the air that is we are supplying in the building at constant humidity. So we are not modifying the absolute humidity of the supply air because of the tightness of this solution. And it is resistant to the ice formation. I think it's not your case. And case of your region, and also it can withstand with a high defensive pressure because of the aluminium, because it is composite by aluminium. But there is one main point of the plate heat exchanger, because we said before the humidification occurs at the inlet of the heat exchanger, but also inside the heat exchanger. We will see later comparison between just humidify at the inlet and humidify the inlet and inside the heat exchanger. Because in that way, we are going to keep the temperature of the airflow close to the saturation curve. So we are working a lot with the wet bulb temperature of the airflow that we are humidifying. Since it is really important to humidify the air also inside the heat exchanger, the surface of the heat exchanger is really important as its dry performance. In fact, the surface can increase the spread of the water on the surface, and also it can retain a little bit the water to reduce the water usage effectiveness. That is a value that represents the amount of water that is needed to have like a certain value performance. Here you can see two small videos regarding the performance of a standard. This is a standard coating that is hydrophobic. As you can see, the water are not absorbed by the surface, they're just going through and they're keeping their sides as droplets, as you can see. And in the video below, instead, it's a coating that could increase, that is called B-Blue, that could increase the performance of the system, the whole system, because this coating is able to retain, as you can see, the water, and also is able to spread. As you can see, there is a thin layer of water that is spreading on the surface. We've seen also in the our lab and the University of Milan lab, we have seen that we had like an increase also in the performance of 10%. The coating, in addition, has got a really important role, as I said before, for the spraying of the water, but also for the for protecting the surface of the aluminium. So permitting the use of all types of water that you have, like tap water, softened, or also demineralized, because it's like a layer that is covering, it's protecting the aluminium from the water. Let's now understand how can we gain from such a solution. How can we obtain if we install heat exchanger and we install a spray system? But it's important to understand how we arrange these two systems together, like the adiabatic humidifier and the plate heat exchanger. There are many configurations. Of course, you can install the humidifier at the top of the heat exchanger, on the side, the bottom, depending on how handling unit layout is made. You can see that from the top, from the graph, this type of table, we have cooling capacity in terms of water sprayed. As you can see, the top performance, this blue line here on the left, it has got the higher cooling capacity, while the side and bottom have a lower capacity. This is because it's really important, I said before, that the water enters inside the heat exchanger, because in that way we are working closer to the wet bulb. Every time the air inside the heat exchanger is heating up and then it's cooled down by humidifying in the next step. So in that way we are working more close to the saturation curve. In fact, with the side and bottom, the gravity is compromise the flow of the air inside the exchanger, and so we are losing a lot of cooling capacity because the water is not entering inside the heat exchanger for both sides and bottom. The heat exchanger in this like configuration works like a water drop separator, let's say, because of the geometry of the heat exchanger inside. So already here we can see how important is it the configuration, how important is it the humidification inside the heat exchanger. Now we are going towards the case study. Before, a few words about the model that we are going to use, we are using. We have done several tests in our lab, several tests in the university lab to build a black box, a model, DLL, that is able to predict the performance of the old system in different configurations and with different also heat exchangers. So this model has been developed and then validated with a big amount of tests that we have done in the Polytechnic of Milan. Now let's go through two main case studies that are quite different one from the other. One is the data center application, that is an industrial application, and the other one is an hospital application. These two case studies are quite different because this first, the data center application, is a system that is a closed loop because the air of the data center is inside a closed loop. So we are using always the same air, and the air that is wetted is the outdoor air. So the air that we take outside, we cool down, we humidify, and then we exhaust away. That's because we should keep tight. It's important to keep tight and closed all the data center system. Of course, in Middle East, the period where you can use humidification, considering the outdoor condition, is not for the whole year, let's say. It's limited to a period. But since it's really high, the quantity of air that we are treating is really high, also the cooling needed for such application, anyway we can still have in this type of application a really low payback time for this application. Just to give you some numbers, we have a data center airflow that is 43,000 more or less cubic per hour at 34 degrees, 27 relative humidity. Instead, the outdoor airflow is 34,000 meter cubic per hour at 40 degrees with 30% of relative humidity. We have a comparison between a situation with a wet pad, as I said before, so we are humidifying just at the beginning, at the inlet of the heat exchanger, with instead a adiabatic humidifier, a medium pressure, so we are humidifying at the inlet of the heat exchanger and also inside the heat exchanger. As you can see, we have a wet pad with an efficiency that is quite high, that is 90%, and we can have like 58.1 kilowatts. That means that from 34 degrees, we go down to 30 degrees, almost 4 degrees less. If we substitute the wet pad with a spray system, then we are going to wet the heat exchanger also, and spraying water, we can have 79.5 kilowatts. That means plus 36%. That's because we are going to spray water also inside the exchanger. In this case, we are not considering the pressure drop, because of course the wet pad has got always a pressure drop for the whole year, for the whole running of the unit. Instead, in this case, another advantage of the adiabatic humidifier is that we don't have any pressure drop apart the one of the plated exchanger, of course. Now, with the hospital application, we are going to see something different, because before we were wetting the outdoor air, now we are going to humidify the extract air. So it's something that is really always stable. A temperature is always, let's say, 25, 26, 24 degrees with a almost constant relative humidity. In this way, we can use the adiabatic humidifier and heat exchanger, so the indirect evaporative cooling technology, for the whole year. So it's easy to understand that with this type of technology, we can really save a lot of energy for running the rendering unit for the hot climates, let's say, for period when we have the outdoor air that has a temperature that is of more that is higher than the indoor temperature. The example is 5,000 meter cubic per hour, the supplier at 31 degrees and 60% of relative humidity. The other one is the outdoor airflow that is 5,000 meter cubic per hour at 25 degrees with 50% of relative humidity. In the case without anything, just the heat exchanger, all the rendering unit that already presented has got like heat exchanger, we have 31 that is going down to 26.6. So we are cooling down the air just with a dry temperature, dry bulb temperature of the extractor. Instead, we are going to install the spray system, the adiabatic humidifier. In that way, we are going to humidify always the inlet and also in the inside the heat exchanger. From 31, we are going through to obtain 25.7 degrees. That means that from 60.4 kilowatts, we are going to obtain 8.8 kilowatts plus 37 degrees. This is that's why it's really important, especially now where we cannot recirculate the air. It's important to find the new solutions that are able to limiting the energy consumption of the rendering unit, especially this one. It's able to cool down the air using just spraying water. So just to summarize, we have seen that the IEC technology, so the indirect evaporative cooling technology, is able to limiting the energy consumption that are increasing due to the COVID-19 because of the avoiding the recirculation solution for both industrial, as you can see the data center, for example, and the ventilation unit application for comfort application, also non-residential application like hospitals. We have seen the heart of the system is composed by the adiabatic humidifier, medium pressure, is able to spray water, inlet, and also inside the heat exchanger, of course, the plate exchanger, because of its tightness, its ability to exchange heat, and also the ability to spread the water inside the whole heat exchanger. And we have seen also that it's important to understand how to install and how to create a dialogue between the heat exchanger and the body humidifier to increase as much as possible the performance of such a solution. Thank you. Like at the end, thanks for your time.
Thank you, Paolo. I have a question regarding the Middle East conditions. We have seen in your example you had a relative, you quoted a relative auto humidity of 30%. That's more an inland condition. What about regions which are close to the sea, which see a quite a high relative auto humidity? Does it have any impact?
Yeah, of course, the outdoor conditions are really important. I mean, we have seen two cases. One is the hospital, where we are going to spray always the extract air. That more or less it has got always the same conditions. So we have a quite low temperature, it's 25, 24, and the other one, the relative humidity is average, like 60, 40%. So in the way, we are just exploiting the conditions that are constant. Instead, regarding the other application where we have to spray water at the to the outdoor air, that of course it depends on the condition of outside. Of course, if you increase the relative humidity of the air, it's harder to spray water and to have the water that is absorbed by the air. But of course, since the system is quite easy to be implemented because it's a spray system and it's just you have to connect the rack that sprays water and heat exchanger, of course, we can have in the a period of time where the humidity is not so high anyway, a really low payback anyway. Of course, the performance is influenced by the outdoor condition in such application, like the data center application. But we have seen that even in a small amount of time, we can recover a great amount of energy.
And one question regarding the cross contamination: is there leakage in this heat exchanger assembly then?
No. The most important thing is that the plate heat exchanger has. Is like it is been because it's really tight. It's really tight for air. It's really tight for water. In our experience, especially for data center application, it is possible to guarantee because how it is built the complete tightness. So it is possible to avoid both contamination of the air and also the contamination by the water. In different conditions, even if we are under pressure or over pressure, because the heat exchanger, how it is built, it can guarantee it can separate the two airflows without any problem.